I was one of the original rebels that got thrown out of high school for not wearing uniform or getting my hair cut. I refused it. I said, nope, I was good at my work. I was in A classes, and they knew I was good at my work, but they insisted that I get a proper haircut and wear the school uniform, and I just wouldn't. So I was probably, I don't know, 16. I went for an audition with a band that was in Sydney called Dennis Williams and the Delawares. And they had a record out and they'd been on telly, and I thought, oh, well, you know, I'm just a kid, but I'll give it a shot, you never know. But I got the gig, you know, it was like, ow, I'm in the Delawares. And that, to me, at that time, I felt like I was in the Beatles.
So how do you then get from 1970 to living in England?
Carver Street went into 1971, and then we kind of had the notion of, this band's a pretty good band, let's take it to England. I got a lot of encouragement from my family, my mum, dad, my sister and my friends, you go over there and do something. So I did. I got on the plane and I went over there, and I landed in London, and I hooked up with Clive Coulson, who'd been a singer with the band Mecca for a while, and he was the sound guy for Led Zeppelin. And I went and stayed at his flat, and obviously working for Zeppelin, he was very well connected. He came in there one day, Clive did, with this little bit of paper with this name Stan Webb written on it and this phone number. He said, Stan Webb, he's got a blues band called Chicken Shack. He said, give him a call, he's looking for a bass player. So I phoned Stan, and then I went for an audition, and I didn't hear anything for a while. And then on my 22nd birthday, I was in a pub in Holland Park, and who should I see in there but Stan Webb. And he looked across, he was quite a tall bloke, he was about 6'1". And he looked across the top of the people's heads and he said, all right. He said, do you still want that gig? And I said, yeah. He said, right, you're in. And I got the gig with Chicken Shack on my 22nd birthday. And even Clive said, he said, look, it's not like joining a real big band. He said, but it's a name band. And they'd had, you know, chart success, and they were quite well-known, Chicken Shack.
After that was Widowmaker, was it?
No, after that was under the same management was Mungo Jerry. And this is about 1973 now. The management of Chicken Shack and Mungo Jerry asked me to leave Chicken Shack and go into Mungo Jerry. Because Mungo Jerry was a sort of more of a pop rock band, you know. So I joined Mungo Jerry, and we had quite a big hit with a song called All Right, All Right, All Right. They never ever did great big like concert halls or whatever, but they did... had very healthy attendance and just played discos and clubs and that sort of thing, you know. But it was playing all the time, which does you're playing great, you know. And after that was when we formed Widowmaker in 75. Luther was forming this band and he asked me to do it. And we had the drummer Paul Nichols from Lindisfarne, Hugh Lloyd Langton, who'd come from Hawkwind, and Steve Ellis, who'd been in a band called The Love Affair. And I think it was Steve that came up with the name Widowmaker. I was in Los Angeles, and I wasn't particularly happy with the way things were going with Widowmaker, because there were squabbles and bitching and boozing and drug-taking, but, you know, it being sort of destructive, and it wasn't going great, and it didn't feel great. So I met up with a friend of mine, an English guy who I'd been in Mungo Jerry with, Dick Middleton, guitar player. And he said, oh, I'm a mate of Ritchie Blackmore's. Well, I knew he was a mate of Ritchie Blackmore's, but he said, Ritchie's here in LA, lives here. He's looking for a bass player for his band Rainbow, because he'd had Jimmy Bain before that. But I think Jimmy and Ritchie had a fallout or something. He said, would you be interested? And I said, well, yeah, as it happens, I would be interested, because I'm ready to do something else. So Dick and Ritchie and I went out for just a couple of beers and something to eat as a social meeting, because with Ritchie, I don't think he'd even audition unless he thought that there'd be a chance that you could get on with him, you know. So I went for the audition after we'd had a couple of nights on the beer together. I went down for an audition, and Ronnie and Cozy were there. Ritchie put me through my paces, you know, try this, try that. And the one thing he did like was I played with a pick, which he liked the sound of bass played with a pick and for the precision of it, you know. At the end of that audition, they just said, well, you've got the gig if you want it. And I said, I'll think about it. Well, I wasn't sure, because I had this sort of you know, the Widowmaker thing was still going, and I had a certain
loyalty to them.
Yeah, a certain loyalty and obligation to at least maybe try to see it through, and you know. But then we did a gig at the Whiskey. I think the next night or something, and Ritchie came along and he saw the gig, and after the gig at the Whiskey, there was more squabbles and bitching and fights and stuff with Widowmaker, and I thought, I don't have to think about it anymore. The decision's been made for me. I thought, that's it. So I walked down the stairs out of the Whiskey, up the road into the Rainbow, where I told Ritchie I'd meet him. And I walked in, and I felt very, very flattered, because as I walked in, he stood up and applauded. And I thought, wow, you know, that's... Ritchie didn't do that, you know, very often.
Mm. With Purple having been the biggest band in the world.
Yeah.
And then get the gig with Ritchie, that would have been a bit of a thrill for your family as well, I would imagine.
Oh, certainly. Yeah, my wife Vicky was as soon as I mentioned that I'd been offered the Rainbow thing, she said, you have to do it. And I said, well, I'm thinking about it. No, you have to do it. You know.
Because again, with prior to that album release of Long Live Rock and Roll, he'd actually tried out like literally dozens of bass players before he decided.
Oh, in LA, that I think they'd tried out about 40 bass players or something. I see a lot of bass players in those days were playing fingerstyle, and Ritchie didn't want a fingerstyle bass player. He wanted somebody to play with a pick for the precision and the speed of the right hand, which was right up my street. So,
Did you play on every song on that album?
I didn't play on every song on that album. Ritchie had already done some of the bass on some of it before I even joined. So we went to... after we rehearsed in Los Angeles for probably a month or something, and I learnt the full set, and we did the full production rehearsal and what have you. We did a European tour of all of Europe, Scandinavia. I think we started in Scandinavia. I think maybe the first show was meant to be in Helsinki, and something happened with the gear or the trucks or something, and we didn't do it. And I think the first show we ever did was in Stockholm. And then we did the Scandinavian tour, and then around Europe and England. Oh, it was great. It was really, really good. It was an enjoyment. And it was, like I said, it was very disciplined. And I loved the discipline of it, because don't forget, I'd just come from Widowmaker, which wasn't that disciplined. And, you know, musically it was good, and it was a good feel in Widowmaker musically. But, you know, the discipline of Ritchie and Ronnie too was what I really enjoyed.
I get that they were a partnership, weren't they?
They were.
It was their band as such.
Yeah,
it was Ritchie Blackmore's Rainbow.
It was called Ritchie Blackmore's Rainbow. And then I think after a while, Ronnie and Cozy wanted the Ritchie Blackmore dropped and just call it Rainbow, which
I think Ritchie did too. I don't think Ritchie wanted Ritchie Blackmore's Rainbow either.
Maybe not. Maybe it was the record company or management or both that, you know, they like to do that. They like to sell something by using somebody's name.
So you've been on the road, then went back into the studio to record the album.
Yes. The album was done right at the end of 77 and then into 78. The very beginning of 78. And then I think in January we went to Japan, and then the album came out while we were in Japan. And we promoted it in Japan. Rainbow were huge in Japan. It was unbelievable. I think we did about 3 nights at the Budokan. They may have even put in another night at the end of the tour as well. So they're very big gigs in Japan and very well received. And some of the places we went, you couldn't go out of the hotel because the streets around the hotel were just filled with young people that were Rainbow fans. Probably a lot of ex-Purple fans and all that. Because Purple were like the Beatles in Japan, weren't they? '77, was like in New Musical Express, which is a music paper, or Melody Maker, which is another one. In the polls, we got best live act of the year.
I think you've been best guitar player for like the previous 6 as
yeah,
well.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah.
But the thing with Rainbow was that huge rainbow that they used to truck around.
Yeah, it was a fascinating thing, but it was a nightmare sometimes. Getting it into halls and getting it out. And also, we used to get a lot of interference through Ritchie's amp from the Rainbow. So I think sometimes we just couldn't use it for various reasons. There's a funny story about there was a promoter called Eric Thompson in Scandinavia. He's Danish. And every band, every act used to always play tricks on him, practical jokes and what have you, you know. And we were in Paris on one of his tours. We'd done the Scandinavian thing, and when we were in Paris, probably Ritchie put him up to it, I would imagine, but the road crew held Eric Thompson down and stripped him and made this harness and strung him up over the rainbow, bollock naked. And the next day on the front page of the paper is Eric Thompson hanging from the rainbow, bollock naked. But the funny thing was, and this is the punchline of the story, he started going really red in the face, hanging up there, and the road crew thought, uh-oh, we've made the harness too tight, or he's can't get his breath or whatever, we better let him down. And they let him down, and they said, are you all right? And he said, yeah, what's right? He said, you were going red in the face. He said, that's all right, I was just trying to shit on Cozy. But Ritchie, Eric Thompson, obviously his initials are E.T., and he actually looked a little bit like E.T. He had a sort of an E.T. sort of face. Yeah. And Ritchie got his passport and took his photo out and put a picture of E.T. in and didn't tell him. And we were going through customs somewhere and he handed his passport and he opens it up and there's a picture of E.T. in there. So they're all calling their mates over.
We're in Austria and there was obviously an incident.
One of the gigs, it must have been Vienna, I think, there was a problem with the hall manager and he had an attitude, and I think when we went on stage the audience got a bit rowdy or something, and this hall manager was being a bit of a dick, and I think he put the house lights on, which really pissed Ritchie off, and then he stood in front of Ritchie during the first part of the show like this, and that was the wrong way to rub Ritchie, you know. So Ritchie lashed out with his foot and this bloke tried to grab him. And then Ritchie, second time, caught him right on the jaw. Poof. And down he went. Like a sack of spuds. And he went down. I think he'd either fractured or broken his jaw. And then at the end, we did the whole show. And at the end of the show, the police were called in and they had sniffer dogs. And Ritchie was hiding in one of the drum cases. And the crew were going to try to smuggle him out. But the sniffer dogs and the police found him and they handcuffed him and jailed him. And he was in jail for a couple of days. It could have been even 3 or 4 days, I can't remember. But the show that was to be filmed was soon after that, which was in Munich. And I know we were supposed to go on around 8:30 or 9 o'clock at night. And Ritchie hadn't made it back from, he'd only just got out of jail in Vienna. And he just made it to the gig, and I think we ended up going on at about 11:30 at night or something, very, very late. But the audience were very patient, and the show was good, as you will see. But it was a real experience for Ritchie to be in this jail for a few days, and then we didn't know, you know, when he was going to get out, or if the tour was going to end, or what was going to happen, you know. So I guess you'd have to talk to him to ask him what it was like in jail and what went on during that time.
It's interesting watching the gig though, how, I mean, the band were incredible.
Well, I'd only been in the band about playing live. I think the tour started in about September. So we'd only been gigging for about a month or something. I'd only been in the band about a month. But, we did a lot of rehearsals and we put in the groundwork for it to be, polished.
What was your first experience with Cozy then? Do you remember just from the rehearsals or did you meet him outside of that?
I don't think I had, but Clive Coulson, the guy I mentioned earlier about the working for Zeppelin and that, he'd been working with Jeff Beck as well, with the Jeff Beck group that Cozy was in, with Clive Chaiman and Bobby Tench and Max Middleton and that. And Clive used to, I think he used to breed Alsatians, white Alsatians. And Cozy came round and bought one of the pups once and I saw him there at Clive's place, and that was his dog was called Heidi. I remember that. Heidi. And that was one of the things that we struck up a conversation about when I first went for the audition with Rainbow. So it was not, it broke the ice. It was like, yeah, just was friendly chatting though, straight away. Oh, he was a great drummer, brilliant drummer. Very good.
Was he pretty wild, or was that just sort of the reputation he tried to, with the car?
You mean lifestyle?
Yeah, lifestyle-wise.
Oh, he drove fast. Wow.
He raced Le Mans, didn't he, I think?
Yeah, he used to race cars, yep. And part of the European tour, he had a Ferrari Dino, and he took that on tour. And so, because in those days we didn't have tour buses, you'd travel either by plane, or if it was a short enough drive, you know, maybe a couple of hundred K or something, you'd do it in Mercedes limos or whatever. But Cozy brought his car over, and I travelled in it with him, and we used to zap along the Autobahn at about 145 miles an hour, which is what, 240, 250 K or something. And it was so low, you know, you'd be flying past these great big juggernaut trucks. And I remember one day he slowed down to about 100 miles an hour, which after doing the really high speeds, it seemed quite slow. And he's driving at 100, and then we're getting closer to the town, and he's dropping back to 90 and that. And when we got there, I said, that was, seemed fairly slow for you, Cozy. He said, yeah, the brakes were playing up. So he drove the car back to England, or he put it on a boat or something, and then got we just travelled in the normal rental cars and that after that.
How do you move out of Rainbow? How did you actually, did you get the elbow or you left or what happened?
It ground to a halt, and it was funny how it was sort of ironic how it all turned out, because during the last part of the American tour, Ronnie started to get, I suppose, inklings that all was not well in the Rainbow and the Ritchie camp with him and the rest, you know. So Ronnie started asking me, he said, look, if this doesn't last, or if it, you know, disbands at the end of this tour, he said, would you be interested in getting a band together with me? And I said, yeah, of course. I said, if this folds, then yeah, I'd like to keep going with you know, if you're going to do something. So at the end of that tour, it was decided that you know, Ritchie was going to get a new lineup. I think he kept Cozy for a while, and then Cozy went as well. But he kept Cozy for a while. But Ronnie phoned me. I was living in London, and Ronnie phoned me and he said, well, it is over. And he said, I'd like to get a band together. Are you interested? And I said, yep. And he said, well, hang in there. He said, I'm looking for guitar players at the moment, and we're going to sort out a record deal, and we'll get some dough together and a budget, and we'll fly you over and we'll do all that. So I was sitting there waiting. Then I'd get another phone call from Ronnie saying, how's everything? We're still taking care of business. And so I was, you know, he just said, well, you know, don't do anything else. This is just going to happen. And so one day I went out and I bought Melody Maker, I think it was, and it's got on the front page, Ronnie James Dio joins Black Sabbath. Oh, thanks for telling me, you know. Mm. But he didn't ever actually really tell me. You know. So Ozzy was out of Sabbath. And then I got a phone call from Sharon saying, do you know any great guitar players or other musicians for Ozzy? But she didn't ask me, she was just asking me for in general. And I said, well, I'll think and I'll have a look around and I'll let you know. So that was the end of Rainbow for us.
Ritchie, or no one from management, said, look, Bob, see you later. He just sort of walked away from a gig, and that's it.
Just sort of, yeah. After the, I think the very last show we did was in New York at the end of the tour. And I think it was, you know, let's wait and see what's going to happen next. But nothing did. Well, you know, not for that lineup anyway. Mm. So, you know, Richard, I guess, made the decision then that he wanted the new lineup. So he got, you know, Roger and... Was it Graham Bonnet was the first singer he had, wasn't it? Yeah.
Did anyone ever talk to you about reunions for that band?
Oh, yeah. I'd actually talked to Cozy not long before he died in about... Oh, what year was it? About probably around 97 or 98, somewhere around there. There was a guy I'd hooked up with in Los Angeles that was very interested in maybe trying to, you know, get a reunion happening and some shows and an album and what have you. And I spoke to Cozy about it a couple of times on the phone. So I didn't actually talk to Ronnie then. But it was you know, there were moves being made to try and put it together to do that. You know, whether Ritchie would have done it, I don't know. I think maybe Cozy had talked to Ritchie or something, because it was getting to the stage where it felt almost like, yes, it's going to happen. But then soon after that, Cozy went, you know, in his car crash. Ritchie and I got on very well together. You know, I've often been asked, oh, what was it like working with Blackmore? Is he a weird bloke, or is he a moody bloke and all that? I said, well, I usually said, you know, I got on fine with him, because I never ever rocked the boat. I just put my head down, got on with it, did a professional job as well as I could, and looked at it and used it as a stepping stone and a good opportunity to work with a big name band that was very professional and very disciplined, which I loved, and I learned a lot from it.